yourself as you come and go. You're welcome to do that, okay? And now, just to get this straight, Craig, you announced about people, and if we're going to go pass the microphone around, where do people sit that?
It's all good.
It's all good?
Yeah.
It's all good? Okay.
I've got my short bread, it's all good.
You've got your short bread? Okay.
And one is a gum shop.
Okay. Thank you.
They're not both short bread?
Nope.
Well, then I don't want them.
My sister made them. Anyway, welcome to you to this this year-end service. We're glad to have you with us. And as you know, it's a fairly informal service today, so you can just help yourselves. And we'd like to wish happy birthday today to tomorrow to little Lucas. That's Phil and Diana Morrow's little grandson. I think he turns 2 maybe tomorrow. And that's Michelle's son and her Parker's son. And also on January 5th to Victoria King. Then congratulations, to Marlene Sim. She became a first-time grandmom on December the 8th. And she's got a little girl, Maddie Eileen. So I'm sure Eileen would be very happy with that name. And then our sympathies go out to Sophie and Rick Sessford. Sophie's brother died in Belleville on December the 21st, and the funeral arrangements are still pending. So those are some of the announcements to be brought to your attention. If you see now, I'll just try and do balance this. He has come to be with us. Thanks be to God. Let us come together in our call to worship as it is printed in the bulletin. Rejoice, for God is with us, Emmanuel.
In the darkness of our world shines God's holy light.
Now there is reason to hope, to love, to laugh, to live.
God is truly with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
You have your voices. You read a hymn book. Would you turn to number 50, please, as we sing Elaine? And we'll do the chorus in French and the verses in English. Let us come together in our opening prayer as it is printed in your bulletin. O God of the Christmas story, we have been busy, but now we pause to listen, to hear, to worship. Calm us, ground us in your word of life. Let the story reveal to us its truth. Free us by your Spirit, that we may lift our voices in song. Free us to sing the praises of our heart. In everything, teach us about Christ, that when we leave here, we may love our neighbors and all we meet. We pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, as mentioned, this is mostly an informal service today with a potpourri of focuses, much like what you may be going to eat or drink. And again, feel free to help yourself even during this service. And of course, we're doing this because we're still in the Christmas season, and you may have some carols that you would like to sing that maybe we have missed singing, or that you'd just like to sing again. Or maybe you'd like to share some Christmas memories from long past, or maybe what you did this time around. Or since this is the last day of the old year, maybe you'd like to share something from this past year. Or since tomorrow starts a new year, maybe you have some hopes and dreams for this coming year. So we've got lots of choices of what we can do today. So just to get things going, and to give you a little time to think, I'll start things off. First of all, I want to say that it is a privilege to be your minister. I thank you. And over the years, including this year, you folks have been so supportive, and I speak really highly of you to others. And as a community and the individuals, you have jumped in there, working hard to do old familiar things, but also to do new adventures when maybe you have felt uncomfortable or inept. So I applaud you, and I think you should all give yourself a clap. Thank you, folks, at Dallas Community this year. Thank you so much. So this year, amongst the highlights of what I remember, because my memory is getting, like, you start, what did they do yesterday? Maybe some of you can relate to that. But some of the highlights of what I remember, I had two weddings in Ontario this year that were especially meaningful for me to conduct. In being here for so long, the weddings were for people associated with this church. One was for Chris Sarka and his beautiful bride, Leanne. Chris is known in his own right here, but he's also the son of the late Lou and Joan Sarka, who were longtime members of this church, and we love them and miss them. And Chris and Leanne's wedding was the anniversary of his sister Judy's wedding, which Judy and Jay, which I also conducted. And the second wedding was for Cody Gills, and his likewise beautiful bride, Victoria. Cody is now living out, he's got a hog farm up near Martintown, Ontario. And I baptized him here as an infant. So it was a privilege to have his wedding. Cody is the grandson of the late Jim and Betty Edwards, and son of their daughter Debbie and her late husband Les. So it was really special to officiate at those services. And I was likewise grateful to God, because on both times coming back, it was raining heavily. I was just involved with situations and driving heavy at night. And both times the good Lord provided a transport trailer with lights that I could follow on the 401 and the highway the 417. So I was very grateful for that. In terms of Christmas, Craig and Angus and I got to go to my family farm on the 26th. There were only 14 there this year, about half of us, so it was quieter. We missed those who couldn't come, but we still had a great time. We also stopped to see my older brother, who was not up to coming. It was good to see him. So that's enough for me. Does anyone have a favorite carol that maybe they'd like to sing this time around? 55. Number 55. In the deep, deep winter. How many verses, Audrey?
Just two.
First two?
How about verse 1 and 2 then?
Verses 1 and 2, okay?
Is that okay?
In the deep mid winter, number 55. What I really enjoyed this year in church was the singing celebration in October, I believe, when Doreen organized this with all the churches. So all these, for me, a lot of strangers, we came together and we practiced a few times and we sang, and it was like they weren't really strangers, because we were all there for the same thing, for the same message, and it was just absolutely fantastic. I enjoyed it so much, I wish we could do that like every year. Because everybody that I spoke to afterwards, when we came downstairs for coffee and tea and cake and all kinds of goodies, everybody was just so happy with that whole evening. It was just, to me, that stood out this year like a shining star, if you want to compare it to a shining star. It was just, to me, that was amazing. That's what I want to say. It was just an amazing day. I hope we can do it again. With all these people that are not strangers anymore. And we made new friends. So that was amazing. Thank you. Thanks, Mary. And I think a lot of people can identify with you. There was just a real sense of real joy and community there. Anybody else with a memory or something they'd like to share?
I will.
Okay.
Get it over with.
As you all know, I've been here a long time. It seems like forever. Actually, it is almost forever, short about 6 years when I moved into the city. But what I remember as a child was our Christmas party with Dave Reed. And we had a lot of kids. We packed this hall. I don't know how many of you were here. I think maybe a few of you were. And they were really good times. I think it was Dave Curry that played Santa Claus. Was it Dave Curry that played Santa Claus? Yeah, we had plays, and we had just, it was just a wonderful time. But one time I do remember two things was my mother always on Christmas Eve would sit down and she'd read us, before they went to church, she'd read us the Christmas story. And she'd sit on the edge of her bed, and we'd all sit on the floor, and she would read us the story. It still brings tears to my eyes when I think about it. It was a beautiful woman. Then I remember one little thing. We didn't get to go to the Christmas Eve service because we were too young. And we had Mrs. Chausset. Audrey, do you remember Mrs. Chausset? Mr. and Mrs. Chausset, he was a bass.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they lived in the Heights down near the Tuckers. And she used to babysit for us all the time. And she used to read us stories. And then there was the first Christmas I was allowed to go to the service. And it was just amazing. Those were in the days when we used to shut off the lights and light the candles. And the church was packed. There were chairs down the aisles. And it was magical, actually. The first time it was awesome. But the biggest part, unfortunately, you probably won't like to hear this, but anyways, we would go to my Grandma Smith's, and my aunts and uncles would all be there. It was a late night thing because they couldn't be there the next day for Christmas, so my aunts and uncles were there. And we'd have homemade shortbread, and we were allowed to have ginger wine. Has anyone ever tasted ginger wine? We used to get that when we were kids, when we'd go skating. There was no alcohol in it. It was just, it was dark, dark, and it had bubbles, and it made your mouth fuzzy. And we felt very privileged to get a little tiny glass of ginger wine. We used to get that when we come in from skating. Our feet were cold, and it would kind of just warm you. You'd drink it, and you could feel it just warm you all. Do they still sell that?
Yes, yeah.
In Canada?
No, I didn't get it in Canada, in Jamaica.
Huh? I'll speak to you about it. Anyways, it's a very fond memory. There's so many, but those are just a few.
Can I pick one?
Sure. I'd like to pick number 71.
71.
Number 71.
71. Okay. What is that, Marjorie?
What could it be?
Was in the moon of wintertime.
71. How many
of our sinners sing that too? It's so beautiful. It's so beautiful.
We need a drum. Okay, how about we do 1 and 4?
This is 1 and 4 of 71.
Adeste Fidelis.
Oh, Adeste Fidelis. Okay, cool.
Well, maybe we better turn the camera off for that one.
Anybody here study Latin besides me?
No, I was singing in Latin.
I did.
You did? Okay.
Oh,
neat. So, Jim, we can sing it in Latin. You know, V is parallels D, like a W, okay?
Thank you.
Makes me think of Bing Crosby. Yeah.
Bing Crosby, yes. Bing Crosby. Yeah. Anybody else have a... Bing Crosby,
can
yes.
69?
Number which one, Rose? 69.
69?
Yeah.
69,
okay.
Oh, yes.
How many verses, Rose?
We have three verses.
All three verses? All three of them? Okay, all three verses of Away in a Manger.
I don't even know where to start. Just being back home with my own dad and all my sisters, Christmas Eve, going to church. And in those days, in Holland, it was very seldom that we had a white Christmas. I just remember one Christmas, we came out of church and it was snowing. Now, I don't know about you guys, but to me that is really magical when it snows on Christmas Eve. And going home, we did light all the candles, real candles, in the tree. And we had a water bucket next to the tree, just in case. And so that was my memory. But somehow, Julie popped into my head, Julie Friedel. And she was our choir director. With Doreen being the organist. But Julie always got into everything, and our ears would turn really red. But, you know, I just wanted to remember her as a very good friend. She was, and she was part of our Sunshine Gospel Singers. And so that's one memory. And I just want to remember my son, that's it.
Can I make a suggestion with Silent Night?
Silent Night? Wouldn't it be nice if you could sing one? If you could sing one in English,
Silent Night.
One in English, one in French, and one in German.
All right.
I know. Besides Eric, I know there's somebody else who can sing it in German.
The first verse is German.
No, it's available.
Are you looking at me?
Okay. Good. That's good.
So where are we starting with this one?
We started with 67A.
67?
A.
A.
And then 67B.
So we go German, French, English?
German, French, English, is that what we're doing?
German, French, English?
Oh, yeah, exactly, yeah.
German, French, English?
Great, you can see that in German too, can't you, dear?
So which one we start, English?
German, French, English.
German, French, and English.
Christmas Eve service here. That was in the days when we had candles and all the lights went out. And Judy, I panicked. And I said, Judy, I won't be able to see the music. She says, don't worry, I'll bring a flashlight. So here we go, lights go down, everybody puts on their candles, Judy turns on her flashlight, and she forgot to check the batteries. There was this faint little pale yellow that started out silent night. By the third verse, there was no candle at all, and therein lies my tradition of playing the last verse a cappella.
Oh, okay.
Funny how traditions start, eh? But things that go wrong. Somebody else got a memory? Another hymn to sing? Why are you thinking? Somebody
want
to say something?
I can share a memory.
You can share a memory, Craig? Okay.
The first year that Alice and I were at seminary, I was totally besotted with Alice. So I was in the hunt. And so it came around to Christmas time, and so I basically let Alice believe that I was stuck in residence for Christmas. And so, of course, being the gentle-hearted person that she was, she invited me out to the farm to be with her family. And so that was my first chance to meet the family and to kind of, from my point of view, take the next step of knowing Alice better and having just the experience was amazing going out to the farm. And I just remember how special it was to be with their family and the way they celebrate completely different from us, but the way they bring everyone in and everyone together was just a wonderful and amazing experience for me.
Poor Craig, he said he was going to be all by himself in residence. Maybe he'd go to his sister's on Christmas Day, you know? And he, when we invited him home, he went out and he sold a very expensive camera to get gifts for everybody. So you can imagine how much he got for that camera. Gifts for everybody. And then he was so confused, the poor guy, because besides us being a big family, we all have nicknames. So it made it even worse. And then Craig's mom said, it was so nice of you to invite him home. And I said he was going to be all by himself. She said, we had his bed made up for him at home. We were expecting him home, so. Anyway, it was great. It's a great memory. Anybody else? One more carol before we...
Number six?
Number six? What's number six, Mariette?
A candle is burning.
A candle is burning. Number six. How many verses?
That's our...
These five verses say at least verse one and verse five.
One and five?
Okay.
Well, some of you may know that I didn't grow up in Chattanooga. I actually grew up in Ontario, a place called Kincardine, which is right on Lake Huron. So we were actually 500 miles away from Montreal at the time. And some of you may also know that my birthday is Christmas Eve, and that most people think that Christmas Eve is a terrible birthday to have because you only get your presents once a year. But I always thought it was the greatest birthday to have because we used to travel from Kincardine to Montreal, so 500 miles on my birthday. So the great thing about it is that my family had no choice but to spend the entire day with me. So from morning till night, it was usually stormy. It wasn't that great out, but I had a captive audience the entire day of my birthday. So I got to spend it all with my mom and my dad and my brother, and they really had no other place to go. So it was always wonderful for me from that perspective when I was a little kid.
Thanks,
sir.
Belated happy birthday. Anybody else? Rose, what happened to you in Jamaica? Did you have a good Easter Christmas down there?
Yes, yeah. But I also missed it now. Because normally at Christmas time, I
go back home in Jamaica with my mom, dad, sisters, but they all passed now. So I feel sad at Christmas, really, because normally I always surprise them, go home for Christmas. But now it's like not happy no more to go, not the same anymore. So Christmas is here in Canada now with my kids, my husband, and my church really family. So I'm happy. Thank God.
Thank you, Rose. Okay, anybody else? Just don't want to block anybody out. Sandra, you have the scripture readings, I think, today, right?
I do.
There you go.
First reading this morning is from Luke 2, chapter 2, verses 1 to 7 on page 832 of your pew Bible. In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world would be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. The second reading is from Colossians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 and 9 to 14. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, and of the love that you have for all the saints.
Oh, there we go.
For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. May God add his blessings to these holy words.
Thank you, Sandra. Well, my reflections are not that long this morning, I promise you, but to prime our thoughts, I want to read these thoughts written by a lady named Nicole Mullis, entitled The Christmas Kidnapping. She writes, "It was Christmas Eve, and we were in the back of the church with the rest of the well-dressed, slightly depressed parents, whose offspring were in various states of unholy discontent. My youngest, an 18-month-old terror in pink tights, was slowly sucking the Christmas spirit right out of me. Around and around the poinsettias, I chased her, dodging the other kids, blocking the exits, and praying for patience. Eventually, she stopped in front of the life-size nativity scene. "Baby," she exclaimed. "Yes, baby," I answered wearily. As she stared at the statues, I wondered why we bothered coming. Church was a challenge on a regular Sunday, and this holiday hoopla was impossible. I didn't hear a word of the sermon. My husband had that frown line on his forehead, and my older children kept asking when they could open presents. I felt lousy. Then I heard a squeal. Turning, I saw my youngest running full tilt with the baby Jesus statue wrapped in her arms. I looked at the empty manger. I looked at my daughter, a golden halo peeking over her shoulder, delicate toes mere inches from the ground. My kid just kidnapped Jesus. Baby, baby, baby. Now, when one's toddler is scampering across the room with a fragile ceramic statue of the infant Savior, you do not simply yell for her to stop. I didn't want her to drop it, nor did I want her to trip and fall on it. So I scurried after, politely pleading for her to give me the baby. It was a holy hostage negotiation. Parents parted to let us pass. My face was 30 shades of Christmas red. Finally, I cornered her and safely recovered the baby Jesus. "Mama! Baby!" I looked at the statue now cradled in my arms. Then I looked at the other parents. Most were smiling, a few chuckled. Suddenly, it dawned on me. Wasn't that the reason I was there? To gather the baby Jesus into my heart and take off running? I may not have heard the sermon, but thanks to my Christmas kidnapper, I got the message. Now, I expect that we can identify with some of that story if we've been around children at Christmas. You just never know what's going to happen, right? I remember when Reverend Rosemary was here, and a few days ago, Margaret Little, who, because of ill health, can't come to church just now, but we were sharing some memories, and she and I were recalling when Reverend Rosemary was conducting the later Christmas Eve communion service that we used to have here. And our son Angus was just a wee tad, he was almost a year old, and Craig was singing in the choir, and I was there to, I was here to share the service with Reverend Rosemary. And we had no babysitter at that time of night, Christmas Eve, so we brought Angus with us. And Valida Lane volunteered to look after him. And I sat with the congregation on the piano side upstairs near the front, and Valida sat in the middle near the front with Angus in his little yellow sleepers. He looked so sweet. And Rosemary's boys, they were all young at the time, they were sitting behind Valida and Angus. And as Reverend Rosemary preached, I looked over, and I saw that Angus had fallen asleep on Valida's shoulder, and he was snoring audibly. And Reverend Rosemary's boys thought it was so funny, and they were laughing. And I had no idea how to fix it without attracting more attention. And I felt sorry for Rosemary, but I also felt sorry for Valida because she probably didn't know what to do with this minister's son that she was holding. So it was a real predicament. So I expect we can identify with that lady and her little daughter being the holy infant kidnapper. But I like her summation of that incident where she says, as she's holding the stolen baby, "I looked at the statue now cradled in my arms. Then I looked at the other parents, and suddenly it dawned on me. Wasn't that the reason why I was there? To gather the baby Jesus into my heart and take off running? I may not have heard the sermon, but thanks to my Christmas kidnapper, I got the message." And so I'm thinking, isn't that a message for us all? We're not meant to leave the baby in the manger. We need to go with him into the new year with us. And that's the hope and the joy of this season. The Archbishop of Canterbury, I think that's his title, he said, Jesus didn't come to serve, he came to save. And you know, thinking about it, doesn't being saved means we can have a fresh start with him? That was one of the things that gave St. Paul and the early church such energy. That they knew that Jesus came to erase their failures, their wrongdoings, and that the God of life, Emmanuel, was indeed with them, as he indeed is with us. He came in person so long ago as that wee baby. And he's all grown up, just like some of the children that I baptized and recently married. But that Christmas baby from so long ago, all grown up, walks with us if we invite him. And he goes with us into the new year with us. Thanks be to God. Right? Amen. Let us turn to number 31 in Voices United as we sing, Oh God, How Shall I Meet You? Number 31.
Thank you.
generosity be our watchword as we offer this money, the generosity of gifts presented, the generosity of faith shared, the generosity of hope declared. Bless our giving through the generous gift of Jesus. Amen.
Come together in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we gather today as a community celebrating your coming as an infant human being into this world so long ago. It's difficult for us to get our minds around that this little human being was also with you before the worlds were created, putting the stars and the galaxies in place, and then this amazing creation of this planet that we call Earth and all its wonders. It's amazing that you should then choose to become one of us, identifying with our vulnerabilities, but also coming in your love to bring us back to you, offering us your forgiveness for rejecting you so long ago. We thank you, Lord God. Lord, we've been here this morning to celebrate your love and to support one another as we leave one year behind and prepare to enter a new one. And as we look back, we will all have experienced joys and times to laugh, but all of us have also known challenges in one way or another, and we have experienced sorrows and tears. We thank you that you know all about it, and you have said that you have come to be with us and to give us hope, saying that you will never leave us nor forsake us, to be of good cheer, for you have overcome the world. Lord God, may we reach out to you and clasp your hand as we walk into this new year. We also pray for this world and all its challenges. We pray for those who make big decisions in regards to others. We pray for your communities of faith seeking to be faithful to you. We pray for the aged and infirmed. We pray for our children. We pray for all those with responsibilities of caring, whether it's parenting or teaching or health or security. We pray for each one gathered here and all the hopes and dreams and the sorrows and the joys that we carry with us and for the loved ones that we care about. We thank you for your presence here this morning. And we pray that, O God, we may be a blessing to you as you are a blessing to us. Once again, we thank you for coming to save us, and we thank you that you are with us if we will let you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us sing Joy Is Now in Every Place. And again, we hope that you can stay for coffee and tea and goodies. And I know some of you have to dash off, but for those of you who can linger, we welcome you. Joy Is Now in Every Place, number 45.
Sure. Okay, time to eat and drink, right? Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Happy New Year.